back to our next clip. You left, or we left you last time, as we were finishing our glossing, or not finishing but starting it, but now we have finished it. I've just took the tapes off this morning, so the colours that you can see revealed by the tape are just the undercoats. Remember, when we do it, we put the coach lines in where we want them and then paint the black and the red in as we want. When we're finished, we take the tapes out, and our next stage will be to tape up either side so that we are left with a band there where we can just get a 1-inch brush in and paint in the coach lines. We'll let you have a look at that when we do it. I've only just taken the tapes off, the paint is dry, but the paint I painted yesterday, the last coat went on, so the tapes came off this morning. Now, I won't tape up until at least 48 hours have passed. Now, I know that sounds a long time, but I want to make sure that the paint is thoroughly dry before we tape up. We are going to tape up right to the very edge of where we've painted. It's going to be nice and tight, sort of a half mil again overlap. But this edge has had tape pressed against it through the whole of our painting operation. So what I'm looking at is basically a wet edge, and we want to make sure that's thoroughly dry before we retape. Otherwise, you'll seal it back up, you've always got a chance then you're just going to lift some paint. It's unlikely, but err on the side of safety. Remember, anytime you use tape on a fairly freshly painted surface, it might even be just the next day, you're stopping that paint from drying, or you're certainly inhibiting how quickly that paint is going to dry. So I have seen it where if you put a piece of tape over what apparently is a dry surface, if you leave it on long enough and the paint is sticky enough, it will actually rip paint off. It will often cut into it because the paint then on either side of the tape has dried and it's still, if you like, wet in the centre. So a little tip there, don't retape too soon. It'll often offer you a few problems. So we're going to leave this to dry out. In the meantime, there's plenty of work to get on with. The runners for the back hatch, they've just had a rub down, they're going to be glossed. The black panel that you can see running down the roof, that's going to be a panel of diamonds. And the reason we put a black panel in there first is when we lay in the fine tapes to divide up the diamonds, once the diamonds are painted, we take the tapes out and you're going to end up with diamonds with a black pinstripe between them. So we've put a couple of coats of black gloss on, then we tape, then we paint the diamonds, then you get pinstripe diamonds, which always looks quite nice, and nice sharp lines between the diamonds. But you'll see that as it progresses. Since you were with us last, we've also taped the back up. I've already started glossing it. This is for the sort of traditional crown line at the back you see a lot of narrowboats with. The patterns change. It was something that companies used for recognition. We've just gone for a fairly simple one on this. Again, we're having to paint, obviously, the black, get that finished, then we'll detape. We'll leave it again. Remember, always leave before you retape. Then we'll retape on the outside, paint the center, and that's going to be again in this rich red. So hopefully that'll look quite nice at the back. The seats to go on here, we've got the legs glossed up, as you can see, in black. And the cans at the back, which are still in undercoat at the moment, they're going to go in again in this deep red with a grey deck, just to give some contrast and some change between the colours. The swan's neck, we've glossed black top and bottom. The tapes on there, the swirl of tapes there, we're going to just intertwine some colours running down the swan's neck again, just to give it a bit of colour and a bit of variation. If you look across, all the doors for the boat are sitting up. They're ready to be painted. They're all in primer at the moment. The other sides are actually have been undercoated. But this boat has had all the insides of the doors, we've renewed all the wood. So by doing that, we're going to paint those later, and then they're going to have some designs put on. So when the doors are open down the side of the boat, we've got a bit of something else going on. So quite a lot of work still to do, but I think you can see now that the boat is actually coming on. Large panels, these are pretty much ready for sign writing now. There's no reason why we can't get that done fairly soon. And then we've got the rest of the boat, the hatches, they're in their first coats, and we've just got the gunwales to pull in. So it's coming on quite nicely. Come and join us a little bit later as we've progressed a bit further, and we'll show you as we do these coach lines and a few tips for painting them. And also we'll have taped up for the handrails, which are going to be in this nice deep red again, and should pull the boat together. So come and join us when we've moved on a little bit further. Okay, we're back on the coach lines. When we left it last time, we just detaped, so we've jumped ahead. We're 72 hours on in the sequence now, so we're going on to the taping. I've just gone down the handrail. It's probably difficult to see, but I am leaving just the minutest amount of this black gloss showing above the edge of the tape. That's to ensure that when I paint the handrail, we know that those two edges are going to marry up and we're not going to get any missed pieces. When you tape these up, as you can see, I've gone and put the glasses on, try to get as close as you can. You don't want to be below the line by any sort of distance at all, so keep nice and tight. Take your time. I like to just stretch the tape out and get it on, and then just ease it on with my thumb as I move along the edge that I'm working with, and then just smooth that down. This is the easy part of taping up. We're only following an existing line, so nothing too tricky. Once you've completed this, obviously you have to do this top and bottom. We're going to paint in the coachline colour, which will just finish the job off. And that will also then bring that coachline up to the same thickness as the two panels either side, the black and the red. So that's all there is to it in the method that we use. If you want to come and join us again very shortly, I'll do a bit of painting, and I'll just show you how I go about painting in between these taped edges. Maybe a little bit different to some people. It's what we do. As you have to remember, we are showing you what we do. We're not saying what we do is the only way or the right way. We're just saying this is what we do. This is the way we go about doing it for our boats. And generally speaking, people seem to be pretty happy with the result. So come and join us when I finish taping up, and we'll go through the painting stage. Okay, well, welcome back. As you can see, we've pulled the handrail in, so that's looking something like now. And as I said, I'll just show you how we do the coach lines. A little bit of controversy, because I'm going to paint these horizontal. Controversy, I don't know if that's the right word, but someone said to me once, oh, that's wrong. You should paint them vertically so it matches the rest of the cabin side. Personally, I don't think there are necessarily rights and wrongs. Some people may say, you know, different. All we're doing is just showing you what we do. Personally, I do them horizontally. In the old days, they would have been pulled in with a lining brush. Quite an art to actually do that, but they would have been pulled in by the sign writer or the boat painter with a brush. And consequently, he would have put those lines in horizontally with a brush. Personal choice. When I start, you'll see it's just as easy really to do them vertically as it is horizontally. I just like doing them this way, and as I say, we're not saying one way is right or another is wrong. All we're saying just how we do it. So I'll show you how we go about it. I've got an inch and a half brush. I don't normally paint out of a tin, but as I'm just pulling in a coach line, I'm not going to bother to decant the paint this morning. Remember, if you're doing a coach line like this, especially if it's a long one, starting here, let's say, and going around and coming back to that point, the paint will already be dry. So I paint both top and bottom at the same time. So let's get started. Inch and a half brush, I've got an inch to paint and there's an inch tape either side. So basically my brush will fit quite comfortably on the coach line there, and I've got no worries about overlapping the tapes. Good quality tape is good. When I finish this, pulling these tapes out, they'll give me a nice sharp line when I've finished. One reason against painting horizontally is if you get too much paint on, you've always got a chance of getting a bit of a sag because you're asking the paint to hold up horizontally as opposed to vertically, so it maybe doesn't spread so quick. And also lapping. If you don't actually brush the paint out, you might see joints or overlaps where I've worked the paint across. But generally speaking, they're not too much to worry about. So as we're just applying the paint there, I'm just brushing in, making sure I'm getting right into the tape edges. Again, good quality tape. You haven't got any worries about your tape lifting or causing any issues with that. We often hear people saying about how fast you have to paint. I'm not painting particularly fast now. I'm not trying to. I'm just trying to make sure I get a good coverage. So just laying the paint into those tram lines there that we've put in. And just brush the paint in nice. And remember to lay off backwards into what you've just painted. And you shouldn't have any problems. Again, remember to keep both lines going at the same time. And I'm purposely just taking my time, not rushing the job. There's no need. And this paint will flow out nicely and leave a very nice finish when we've done the job. So that's all there is to it. I'm probably going to step in front of the camera now, but all there is to it, just keep moving that line back, top and bottom as you go. And remember, when you're painting, to actually, I know this is going to sound funny, to actually paint, work the paint into the surface with nice brush strokes. If you're worried about splashing, and you see that sometimes, a bit of paint flicking here and there, often the cause is your brush is not kept in contact with the surface you're working on. Now, as I'm painting that little bit, my brush hasn't left the surface. I'm just pulling the brush backwards and forwards over the surface. And then finish off again, laying that off. The reason I'll mention that is you often see people paint and at the end of each stroke the brush actually leaves the surface. So if it would go to there and they sweep and then go back on and it comes off at that end. You will tend to flip paint and get little flecks of paint shooting in all directions if you do it. If you can keep your brush in contact, I'm sort of trying to exaggerate that now, look, but if you can see that staying in contact all the time, it works the paint into the surface and also stops any flicking action with the brush. So it's not a long-winded job to complete. So say you don't have to rush, go too mad with it. Just take your time, and then you end up with the finish you were looking for. Now I'll just do very briefly a short bit with relaying off in the other direction. Oh, I can't obviously leave it. So you'd still apply the paint in the same way, and then it would be a case of laying off like that, so that it should any remaining brush strokes be left, they'll be with the work that you did. Now, as I said, I don't do it. It's a personal choice. Either way, I certainly wouldn't argue one way is right and one way is wrong. It's just the way we do it here. So it was the way I was shown to do it in the first place, and the reason behind was given to me that it was how it would have been done with a brush in the old days, before we had the options of using tapes. And we've stuck to it. So I make no apologies. Come and join us on the next bit of our clip, and we'll show you a few more of the techniques that we use in completing the job. We are getting towards the end of the job, so some of the things we're looking forward to doing will be completing the gunnels, leaving a sanded finish on those, and some of the little bits of detail around hatches and things. So hope you've enjoyed this little bit, and we'll see you again next time. Welcome back. We said at the end of the last clip we'd show you a few more of the techniques. We've detaped. You saw us painting in the coach lines. I always take the tape off an hour or two after the last coat's applied. The reasoning behind that is the tape cuts through that last coat nice and clean. As you can see, we end up with some very nice sharp lines. But we've moved on a section from there. We've started on the gunnels. Again, we're heading towards the end of the job, so we start working our way down now. And the gunnels have been given a coat. We use multi-40 deck paint. We've coated all the gunnels, haven't rubbed the primer down. And now we've got to the stage where we've just keyed up the surface. We've laid our tapes in. Now, you may find this interesting, but when we tape up, we always put a half inch tape next to the cabin side. The reasoning behind this is when the water, when it's raining, any moisture runs down the cabin side, it actually leaves the cabin side and isn't trapped alongside in the sand or your textured surface. So that's the reason for that, just to give the cabin side freedom from moisture right at the weld. You will notice there are other tapes. Under any drains or any doors, directly underneath, I'll put a break in the tape or a break in the sand. The idea being that as the water runs off the roof, it'll run down the cabin side and make a free way straight onto the straight into the canal. We do that wherever there are breaks or doors, anywhere it's necessary to make sure that water can run away freely. It is worth doing. Water trapped up against the cabin side, especially in sand, it will stay wet for a long time. You've always got that chance then of water penetrating and causing some rusting along the weld edge. So that's why that's there. The actual sanding process is fairly straightforward. What we do is we give the gunnels a complete coat of paint. We then rub down the surface, tape up, apply the sand into a wet layer of paint, and then tomorrow, when it's dry, we'll hoover off any excess sand that hasn't stuck, remove all the tapes, and then apply another coat, not only to the top of the gunnel, but also to the sides. That way the sand has been actually sandwiched between two coats of paint, and it's also within a coat of paint itself. This means when you walk on it, it's hard wearing, you don't kick the sand off, and you don't certainly allow moisture to get into your work. So that's the way we do it. I'm sure there are lots of other ways, and you can buy texture which you can pour into paint to give you this surface where you just apply it and the surface is already textured. We do it this way, it's the way we like to do it. We like this finish that we get, and hopefully when the boat's completed, we'll be able to go around and show you the finished product. Okay, so what I'm gonna do, apply a coat of paint, and then I'll show you how we put the sand on. We use a roller. There's no need to brush this. The roller's gonna leave a bit of texture, but we're only sprinkling sand into it, so it really doesn't matter at all. So all we need to do is just roller all the way along there. Now you will notice that a roller will apply paint right to the actual edge of the gunnel. There's a reason for that. I know some people leave a little break. They've run a piece of tape along the edge so that the sand doesn't go right to the very edge. But I always worry that if you're gonna slip off, you'll slip off off the edge of the gunnel. So we sand right to the very edge, hopefully ensuring that if your footing isn't good, you won't slip off the edge if it's got some texture there to support your foot. So that's the reason we do it, a little safety item really. And so far it's worked for us. I've got a little bag of sand, a couple of pieces of muslin with some baked dry sand inside, and all we do is just shake that out, and that gives us a nice almost suede effect finish, which will look very nice when this dries out and has a second coat over the top. You could literally shovel the sand on if you wanted to, and obviously it will stick to wherever the wet paint is. I like doing it this way. I think you get a little bit more control over it and you get a nice finish. So that's all there is. A layer of paint, a layer of wet paint which is sanded, and then as I say tomorrow, we'll hoover it down and apply a coat over everything to seal it all in. And that's the way we go about sanding our gunnels. Come and have a look when we're finished, and I'll leave it up to you to make your decision on whether you think it's a nice finish or not. Welcome back. We've moved on a little bit since you were with us last. The last episode, I was just sanding the gunnels. They've had their last coat, having hoovered the sand off, we put a last coat on, so the gunnels are complete, and all the final little bits and pieces we've done. So it's second and third coating of glosses, as you can see now, the crown line's complete, and all the fixtures and fittings have been replaced. We do like to try and send a boat out looking as fresh as we can, so all the brass work has been cleaned, lacquered, so hopefully that will stay looking good for a year or two to come. This boat's had a new set of fenders, so they've been fitted, and as you can see, as soon as I get out of the way, the sunrise has been and done his stuff, and as ever, he's made a fantastic job. Lovely bunch of flowers he's done on the top there, a bunch of lilies, and some fantastic artwork. And if you're doing a boat yourself and it gets to the signwriting stage, it really does pay to have a top quality signwriter come and do it. I'm not saying anything against stickers or other means of putting your stamp on the boat, but get a good quality signwriter. There's none better than John Leeson. Give John a ring and you can have pretty much anything you want put on your boat by this guy. He's first rate. John's gone now, obviously the work's finished. We've got a nice panel of diamonds down the center. Nice two-tone pigeon box there. I think that looks quite nice against the fresh brass work. The boat had a new hatch made, so that's been painted up and refitted. That's all done on rollers, so no dragging the hatch backwards and forwards. And it's worth mentioning that, you know, if you're thinking about having your boat repainted, have a thought about anything that you might want to change. But it's always disappointing if you get to the end of a paint job, or you get your boat back and then the hatch that always stuck still sticks. This is the ideal opportunity on a repaint to get all these little bits and pieces done. This one's, you can tell the foam's up now. We're not worried so much about humidity and air temperature now. The boat's finished. So it's a case of us now just giving it a wipe over, getting the finger marks off, and handing it over to the customers. The two panels, or the change in colour, I think I'd like to think works. The owners are very pleased with it. So we've got the more traditional back cabin area, engine room area, and then we've got this nice break and some nice long lines. But as you can see, talented as the signwriter is, he's done the doors so that when they're open, and this is the owner's initials, that's gone in there as well. And it's little touches like that. So if you are thinking about doing some work yourself, things like that make a huge difference. We're hopefully going to be able to sort of do some before and after shots that will merge together, so you can actually see how much has changed from the original boat through to what we've ended up with now. As I say, the customers have seen it, they're happy, windows are all in, brasswork's all complete, just more decorative work on the bow area, which we'll probably try and edit into the rest of this clip so you see the full boat. I'd like to think we've shared a lot with you. There is a stage that it's not the same watching as it is coming and doing it. So if you're going to tackle a roof, cabin sides, you want to repaint some panels, whatever the work is, just remember you can always come on one of our courses, and the difference is there, we'll stick a paintbrush in your hand and you can actually have a go yourself, which makes a big difference to just watching me do it. So keep that in mind. It is possible, and one of my students works with me now. He's extremely good and he can paint to this standard, having done one of my courses. It's not rocket science, it just needs a little bit of thought, a little bit of preparation, and maybe just a bit of guidance from somebody in the game. So have a think about that. If you want that extra help, we're here. And as I said, you know, we set that course up to help boat owners paint their own boats. Obviously we paint them for you if that's what you want, but the course was really set up to help you paint your own boat. And this little series we've done is there, and it's put together again so that you can paint your own boat and work on your own boat. But the detail, the finer detail, you may be better coming on a course and just being able to pick my brain, ask the questions that you'd like to know. So this won't be the last. Hopefully we'll put together another little mini series, or as of things crop up, certain little jobs, maybe a more modern and less traditional look. We'll do a few clips in the future and just keep it ticking over so you can see what we're doing down here and how we're progressing. So I hope you've enjoyed the series. It's been fun to make. We will be doing some more, and I look forward to seeing you next time.